There are a few questions that, depending upon the answers to those questions, it really predicts how successful a couple's recovery will be. Regardless of who's unfaithful, regardless of the severity of the infidelity or the addiction, how a couple answers these questions completely sets the tone for the future. Some of those questions include, is the relationship the biggest priority in their lives right now? Another question is, does the betrayed spouse feel like a priority in both life, in recovery, and the overall status of their lives as a couple? Another question, a bit more broad, is, are you as a couple, but also you could point this question at the unfaithful, are you doing what you can with what you have? I'll be the first to tell you that I understand living with limited resources. I understand what it's like to be flat broke and lose everything at least 3 times in my life. I am more than empathetic to the fact that sometimes you just don't have resources, but you can still be creative. You can still be strategic. You can still do recovery work. And if you don't know this, on our website, affairrecovery.com, there is a free First Steps boot camp that you can do. It's 7 days. It's very thorough. It takes most people 7 to 14 days to do it because of the amount of reading. But don't tell me that you can't do anything because everything costs money, but yet here's a free program staring you in the face. So go to affairrecovery.com, click on the First Steps Boot Camp, and you will be off and running. If the answer to any of those questions is a no, I can almost guarantee you that that couple and both those spouses or partners are going to struggle extensively in the recovery process. The truth of the matter is, if a betrayed does not feel prioritized, and if the relationship is not a priority in their life, I can just assure you there's going to be struggle, there's going to be issues, there's going to be an extremely rocky road ahead. Listen, I'll be the first to tell you that in repair work from infidelity or addiction, there is no easy button. It does not exist. I tried it. I went on a long search to try and find that easy button to push and make everything better in an instant. It doesn't exist, but there is an easier button. And I can assure you that if you will make the relationship a priority, if you will make recovery work a priority, it does get easier. But I can tell you, I talk to so many people all over the world through YouTube or our website or what have you, and other mediums, including Twitter. I can tell whether or not the relationship is a priority or whether or not recovery work or repair work is a priority to the unfaithful. And if it is not, get ready, because the future is just rough. There's no way around it. We unfaithful spouses, we don't get it. We get so upset, so angry, so frustrated. We rage at the fact that we just can't seem to gather much momentum, and things just continue to go awry. Our betrayed spouse is just furious, and nothing's ever good enough, and they just don't get it, and I can never make them happy, and they're never just okay. And while I understand that frustration, while I've said those words and those sentences a million times, when I started to understand a few things, it got much easier. And Samantha reacted with far more grace and patience and tolerance and acceptance, because I would say, if I were to put a number on it, at least 70% of it was me understanding that if she didn't feel like a priority, if the relationship didn't feel like a priority, things were going to stay rough. And quite honestly, the relationship was in extreme jeopardy. And I wasn't, and Samantha wasn't sure that things were actually going to work out. Yes, we were being physically intimate sometimes. Yes, we were having some good times and some good moments, and sure, things got a little bit more peaceful, but Samantha admitted to me later on that she still was doing those things, but she was not convinced that our relationship was going to make it. She still had this extreme fear because of a few things I'm going to share with you today. We can do a lot of things. There can be a lot of activity. We can be intimate with our spouse. Things can appear like they're going well, but if our betrayed spouse or partner doesn't feel a few key things, I can assure you the relationship as a whole is suspect. The future is suspect. And if you were to interview that betrayed privately in a room without anybody there, without a recording going on, they would express to you, like they do to me, great fear, great apprehension in moving forward because of a few things. Number one, if the relationship is not a priority, if repair work is not at the top of the list, the betrayed is incredibly insecure because, number one, they want to be won back. I mean, at the end of the day, Samantha told me time and time again, I just want you to pursue me. I just want you to show me that you want it because my heart is broken. My life is shattered. Why would I not want to feel won back by you? Why would I not want to feel as though you're so concerned at winning my respect, my love, my attention, my devotion? Why would I make myself incredibly vulnerable to you when there's no or very little desire or very little manifestation of that alleged desire to win me back? Why would I want to become so vulnerable with you when I see very little of a desire to win and woo me back? Sure, you're home. Sure, you've got a job. Sure, you kind of check the boxes, but that's not enough. The mere fact that you're here is not enough, Samuel. I'm wanting and hoping to see that there's a humility and a genuine desire, an authentic desire for you to win me back. Because she admitted to me, you've lost me. I'm kind of here. And I'm not saying that you have to be my slave or any weird connotation like that, or that you're going to be my doormat that I'm going to wipe my feet on. But if you think that I'm just here automatically and that I'm going to stay here without this manifestation of your desire to win me back, you've got another thing coming. Another thing that Samantha wanted to see and eventually started to see it was that I was willing to sacrifice almost anything and everything to win her back, to make her priority, to make recovery work a priority. Yes, we went into some debt in order to see Rick and do an EMS weekend years and years ago. Yes, I did not go play golf with my one buddy. I didn't ride my motocross bike two or three times a week. I would maybe ride motocross once a week. I would prioritize connection time with her. I sacrificed. Now, before you think that I'm saying, look at all that I sacrificed for you, Samantha. No, 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 not at all. Maybe the better word is prioritized. But I do believe, and Samantha has told me time and time again, when she saw me sacrifice other things I could be doing for her, it generated momentum. It generated love. It generated kindness. It generated an awareness inside of her. Look, he's making sacrifice. This is important to him. If you're an unfaithful, doing those types of things is going to eventually gain momentum, and your spouse will start to say, it appears that I'm a priority to them. Number three is what I call a resilient pursuit of the betrayed spouse. Let's face it, the betrayed doesn't always want to be pursued. The betrayed doesn't always want to talk. The betrayed doesn't always want to be with you, certainly not always want to be intimate, isn't even sure they want to be in the relationship. And as an unfaithful, if you can't be resilient, and if you constantly get your feelings hurt, if you constantly resort to, it's just never good enough, and all of those different slogans, it's not going to be a very successful, enjoyable, or momentum-building process. You just have to be resilient. At the end of the day, we caused this agony. And there were times where I maybe bought things for Samantha. There were times I asked her to go on dates. There were times I asked her to sit and talk, watch a TV show, and she would turn me down. Sometimes very nice and very kindly, sometimes very rude and very trite. But I realized through a lot of help that I had to be resilient in my pursuit of her. Just because the betrayed wants to be pursued doesn't mean that they're going to entertain every request, every desire, every petition. They might turn you down time and time again. And there's a litany of reasons why. Maybe they're moody, maybe they're angry, they're testing you. Who knows? You don't need to know. The fact that you do need to know is that you are going to be resilient, but yet respectful. You can't be rude and constantly complain and demean them if they turn you down. You're going to have to be resilient in your desire to take them on dates or reconnect or talk or just listen and be with them because you're trying to show them that they are a priority. The next one is they have to be the biggest priority of your life. If they don't feel like they are the biggest priority in your life, get ready. There's going to be struggle. There's going to be doubt. And then that struggle and that doubt is going to spill over into an inability of them to be romantic, passionate, intimate, not even just physically intimate, but emotionally intimate because they're constantly worried whether or not you're all in. If they have a worry that you're all in or not, it's going to be a very insecure environment. Now, I just heard so many of you say, Samuel, I'm an unfaithful. I'm constantly trying to show them that I'm all in. And I just want to appeal to you unfaithful, and I think many of you betrayeds will put your rubber stamp of approval on this. It's going to require that you unfaithful are incredibly patient. I could probably do a whole blog just on this. You're going to have to be incredibly patient with their distrust of you being all in. Even if you do everything right, they will still have, for a season, that doubt of whether or not you are all in. It's not necessarily a you thing, that's an infidelity thing. Because infidelity rips the rug out from underneath them and perpetuates this distrust that you want to be with them, that they are most important to you, that you love them and you care for them. So your retort may be to me, Samuel, I constantly try. I get it, but it's infidelity. And you're going to have to be patient. And the average, maybe normal spouse that wasn't dealing with infidelity could be maybe satisfied with some of the things that you're doing. But because there has been a traumatic event, a life-changing event, you're going to have to continue and continue for anywhere from 12 months to maybe 3 years to really regain the true belief in their heart that you want to be with them. And if you label them as, well, you're just being insecure and you're just being this and you're just being that, you are missing it and you are going to wound them. That is one of the biggest struggles of infidelity, is there's going to be a doubt in their heart and mind for quite some time. It could be several years. It doesn't mean that they won't love you and be with you and even be all in with you. But there is a running doubt that lasts for years in their mind of whether or not they are who you want to be with. And you're just going to have to deal with that. I can't fix that. I can't make that go away. You can't either, because that's what infidelity does to them. The last factor, and Samantha kind of really drove this home to me, is she said, you know, I wanted you to have this significant want-to factor, that you genuinely wanted to do this in spite of the inconvenience, the never-ending inconvenience that it all required, right? From counseling appointments to online courses to an EMS weekend or all the different things that you may be doing, there is a significant amount of inconvenience. It just is. Life moves fast. If you've got kids, it's even faster. Businesses, companies, demands, voices constantly calling for your attention. She said to me, when despite the fact that it was inconvenience, I pushed through. And when we as unfaithful push through and overcome the inconvenience and aren't just checking boxes, but genuinely want to do repair work, we are cultivating security. We're cultivating a sense of relief deep in the heart of the betrayed. We are cultivating intimacy because we are showing them that they are the most important thing in our lives right now.